brought to you by Penguin.
The Roses of No Man's Land by Lyn Macdonald. Read by Alison Dowling. This book is dedicated to the nurses, the doctors, and the soldiers whose stories it tells, to the tens of thousands whose stories will never be told, and, in salute, to the generation to which they all belonged. Author's Foreword. I am not good at titles. The titles of my books tend to be baldly descriptive rather than imaginative. Somme, 1914, 1915, Passchendaele. But the title of this book arrived ready-made. So much of a chicken-and-egg situation that I'm not sure which came first. I was working for the BBC on a radio documentary on an aspect of the First World War and, looking for some suitable music, had called up from the archive a selection of ancient tapes made from early recordings. Some were only a minute long, some were double-sided, some were double-tracked, and the floor was covered with tiny reels holding scraps of tape when we heard it. It was sung in a cracked tenor voice in a crackling recording, but the words were perfectly audible. It's the one red rose the soldier knows. It's the work of a master hand. In the war's great curse stands the Red Cross nurse. She's the rose of no man's land. And that was it. What a title. But this is not a woman's book. It is simply a different aspect of the experience of war. A war that was waged behind the battlefront by another army of doctors, nurses, orderlies, ambulance drivers and stretcher bearers, the vast majority of them volunteers, who were just as much on active service as the soldiers in their care. Anyone who doubts this need only visit the vast military cemetery on the road that runs along the coast between Boulogne and Etaples, where the vast tented hospitals were set up. Each gravestone in the long first row commemorates a doctor, a nurse, a VAD or an orderly who was killed in an air raid or who died of disease or infection, and throughout the cemetery there are many more. But despite the fact that I have occasionally found it irksome when people have referred to your book on nurses, there is no getting away from the fact that if the ghost that haunts Ypres and Arras is the glum British Tommy slogging along with rifle and pack, then the ghost of Boulogne, Etaples, and Rouen ought to be a girl. She's probably called Elsie or Gladys or Dorothy. Her ankles are swollen, her feet are aching, her hands reddened and rough. She has little money, no vote, and has almost forgotten what it feels like to be really warm. She sleeps in a tent. Unless she has told a diplomatic lie about her age, she is 23. She is the daughter of a clergyman, a lawyer, or a prosperous businessman, and has been privately educated and groomed to be a lady. She wears the unbecoming outdoor uniform of a VAD or an army nurse. She is as much a part of the war as Tommy Atkins. In the course of over 2 years' research and preparation for this book, I spent hundreds of hours talking to octogenarians who were nurses, soldiers, orderlies, and doctors. What comes through most strongly is their remarkable resilience, the casualness with which they refer to work in circumstances and situations which would appall most other people, the matter-of-fact way in which they refer to their war wounds. Oh dear, I'm sorry to be so clumsy. It's these stupid stiff fingers of mine. It was an apology I heard literally scores of times as a photograph slipped to the floor or two drops of tea slopped into a saucer. The stupid stiff fingers are mostly scarred where they were lanced to release the pus from a septic hand. The soldiers' wounds were pouring with sepsis, and inevitably, through a cut or a graze or a broken chilblain, the nurses who dressed them caught the infection. The medical teams were fighting death and disease without the benefit of the weapons of antibiotics, sulfonamide drugs, or effective painkillers. It is not an understatement to say that drugs like these, together with modern techniques of plastic surgery, blood transfusion, skin grafting, and the treatment of burns, had their beginnings in research born of necessity during the war. If nothing much came out of battles at the front, the same cannot be said of the mirror image battles in the hospitals and laboratories behind it. On the face of it, no one could have been less equipped for the job than these gently nurtured girls who walked straight out of Edwardian drawing rooms into the manifold horrors of the First World War. It was all a far cry from the old myth of the ministering angel. These girls had to be tough. They worked in flooded operating theatres in Flanders where, in a big push, there might be 4 operations going on at one time, and as many as 10 amputations an hour. They nursed men with terrible wounds and saw them off to convalescent camp, or laid them out when they died. They nursed in wards where the stench of gas gangrenous wounds was almost overpowering. They nursed men choking to death as the fluid rose in their gassed lungs. Men whose faces were mutilated beyond recognition, whose bodies were mangled beyond repair, whose nerves were shattered beyond redemption. They turned into a generation of redoubtable grandmothers or, more precisely, maiden aunts, because most of the men of their age group, whom they might have married, never came back from that war to end wars, and they themselves came back to a changed world. Of course, some did marry, but the others were not content to return to the old life of busy idleness, even if circumstances had made it possible. Nor were they content to sit around mourning their lot as the surplus women, which society unflatteringly called them in the 20s and 30s. They shortened their skirts, bobbed their hair, flattened their chests, and, having proved beyond argument during the war that women could do anything, set out to carve themselves a place in what was still a man's world. They moved wholesale into commerce. They became teachers, doctors, social workers, pharmacists, journalists, ran dairies and chicken farms. They won the vote and the right to work in the face of formidable opposition and the obdurate philosophy that a woman's place was in the home, even though such hopes as most marriageable girls had of husband and children lay buried with their men on some far-off battlefield. They earned liberation long before liberation earned itself a capital L. Part 1, 1914 to 1915. Chapter 1. The coast of France was the frontier between two worlds. For the unseasoned soldiers packed into the cross-channel ferries, the pleasure steamers, and the cattle boats pressed into service as troop ships, it was the gateway to the war. The real start of the journey towards that unknown front, where the guns rumbled and flashed in the east. For the battle-weary troops, pouring joyfully out of ramshackle trains at the Gare Maritime, kicking the sticky trench mud from their boots as they bounded up the gangway of the leave boat, it was the first stop on the journey home. For many of the badly wounded, whose journey ended at one of the camp hospitals on the edge of the sea, it was the last stop before eternity. From the packed deck of a troop ship on a dull day, even before the denser grey of the coastline itself began to peer through the channel mist, the marquees of the cliff-top encampments were the first sign of landfall. They stretched along the cliffs, snaking south from Calais round Cap Grenet to Wimereux. They straggled up the slopes of the hills around Boulogne, They stood, ranked behind the line of sand dunes along the road to Etaples, ran on to Merlimont, Amberg Plage, beyond Le Touquet, and swept into Normandy by way of Le Tréport, Deauville, and Troville. Yet even that long line of hospitals, whose canvas tents flapped in the sea winds on the French side of the English Channel, was a mere drop in an ocean of sickness and suffering that beggared description. A European war had long been thought to be inevitable, but before 1914, no lunatic imagination could have envisaged that half the youth of half the world could be sucked into a conflict that would rage across the sodden westlands of France and Belgium, among the sandstorms of Egypt and Mesopotamia, on the high peaks of Alsace, among the mountain passes of the Tyrol, on the barren rocks of Gallipoli, in the hinterland of Africa, and across half the oceans of the world. It would likewise have been dismissed as the half-crazed ravings of an idiot had it been suggested that the invincible British army, which had beaten Napoleon at Waterloo, tamed the Russian bear in the Crimea, sorted out the Boers on the South African veldt, and garrisoned an empire which stretched around the globe, would be ordered to retire as it fired the first shots in its first engagement, and that the name of Mon would go down in history not as a famous battle, but as a famous retreat. On the heels of its burnished cavalry, the first infantry contingents of the British Expeditionary Force made their way towards Mons in the manner of a rambling club, setting out on an enjoyable holiday hike. It was true that the hobnails of their army boots slipped on the deceptively round and smooth-looking cobbles of the French roads, and that there were twisted ankles and mammoth blisters to be doctored and cursed at the end of the day. But even that was not sufficient to dampen the festive spirit of the troops. There had been a holiday atmosphere ever since they had disembarked a few days before at Boulogne. It seemed as if the entire population had turned out to welcome the BEF with flags and flowers, kisses and cheers of welcome. They swept in a babbling, enthusiastic throng alongside the soldiers marching to the transit camps, occasionally sweeping a rank or two of stragglers into a convenient roadside cafe to toast the entente cordiale and bearing them back to their units many convivial hours later. It was fortunate that their officers, only too relieved to find themselves with a full complement at morning roll call, and perhaps too concerned with grappling with the problems of transporting their forces from point A to point B in a foreign country, discreetly turned a blind eye to the excesses of the previous evening. Point B, in the case of the 4th Battalion, the Middlesex Regiment, turned out to be the village of Tessonnière, 25 kilometres east of Valenciennes. They travelled in comfort by passenger train, and the sensation caused by their arrival in the midst of the peasants harvesting in the fields only added to the hilarity of the soldiers, already agog with the excitement of the strange sights and sounds of France. At the appearance of 1,000 men in unfamiliar but unmistakably foreign uniforms pouring out of the train at the country station, the peasants ran for their lives, shrieking in panic, apparently under the impression that the dreaded German invaders had adopted the simple expedient of purchasing rail tickets to French destinations. When they realized their mistake, the villagers rose heroically to the occasion, which was more than the troops could say of their officers. The colonel had been given a lead as to what was expected, in the form of a smacking, hairy embrace administered by the mayor, but to the ill-concealed derision of the battalion drawn up behind them on the village square, the officers received the bouquets presented to them by a bevy of expectant village girls with salutes which were uncompromisingly military. Fortunately for the honour of the regiment, the disappointed welcome committee, which was only too anxious to be compromised, proceeded to present single blossoms to all the rest of the battalion, which was only too happy to oblige. The manifestation of mutual.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.